Hello everyone. Welcome to the series of lectures on the course Calculus and Numerical Methods. In this session, I will discuss a very important theorem in calculus known as the Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem. So before stating Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem, we will form the base work for the proof of that theorem. Okay, so I will give you one situation, okay, and that will form the motivation for what is to follow. Now, supposing you are on an island and scientists have predicted that a volcano will be erupted here. Okay, let's say here a volcano is going to erupt here. And so tourists are come to this island to watch this iconic scene. Okay, so what local people have done is they have built towers here on the island for the visitors or the tourists to, you know, see the event. Okay, so I will just draw the towers here. Let's assume that there are infinitely many towers built here. So I will serially name the towers. Let's say this, the first tower is here. I will call it tower 1, right? And supposing the height of this tower is x1. Okay, so this is tower 1 and its height is x1. And then suppose this is second tower of height x2. Okay, let's say this is the third tower of height x3. This is the fourth tower of height x4. Supposing this is tower 5 of height x5, and this keeps on going. So there are infinitely many towers built here. All right, so let me draw one more and so on. Okay, so this is x6, this is 7. Yes, and so on. Now, the viewers who will be on top of the towers here, who want to witness this event, which tower will be most preferable tower for them? Definitely, they will prefer a tower whose height is maximum and which is farthest away from this volcano. One thing. Another thing is, if I am picking up one tower, let's say x3, then I will prefer x3 only if all the towers ahead of x3, that is x4, x5, x6 and so on, are less in height compared to x3. Right, so which tower the visitors will prefer? The highest tower with the maximum height, preferably, which is farthest away from this volcano. And all the towers after that selected tower, the height of those towers will be, should be less than the selected tower. Such a tower will be most preferred. Okay, so which towers will be the most, you know, the best suitable for the visitors to see this volcano? Okay, so the towers are named serially as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on. So a tower, nth tower will be coming in the most suitable list of towers if whenever I take any tower m after the tower n. Okay, whenever I take any tower m after the tower n, the height of the mth tower is less than the nth tower. That is, xm is less than xn. Okay, so let me draw the nth tower here. Let's say this is of height xn. So this tower xn, the nth tower will be selected, will be the most suitable one if All the towers after this tower are having height less than this tower. Okay. So those towers will be coming inside this collection, which I am calling, yeah, this collection I am naming it as capital A. Now, when will I say that a tower P is not there in this collection? When will I say that one tower is not there in the collection of the most, you know, preferred towers? This will happen if there is some tower which is after this tower P, whose height is greater than the tower P. Okay, so a tower P will not come in this set S if there is a tower M after the tower P, such that the height of the mth tower is greater than the pth tower. Okay, so such a tower will not come in the most, you know, preferred towers. Okay, I hope that's clear. So with this idea, I will go on to prove the upcoming theorem, which says every sequence of real numbers has a monotone subsequence. You pick up any sequence of real numbers you like, that sequence will definitely have a monotonic subsequence. Now, when I say monotone subsequence, it could be either increasing or decreasing, anything. But I will be able to produce at least one monotone subsequence. Okay. So let's prove this. I will start with one sequence of real numbers. So let xn be a sequence of real numbers. Let xn be a sequence of real numbers. So from this sequence xn, I have to produce one sequence which is a monotone sequence, and it should be a subsequence of this sequence xn. Okay, so I will form a set. So consider a set named capital S. Consider the set capital S, and in this set I will take all those natural numbers n. Okay, I will collect all those natural numbers n such that whenever I take a natural number m higher than n, xm must be less than xn. Okay, a similar set I just defined here, and you all know now what this means. All right. So I will collect all those natural numbers such that whenever I take any natural number m after n, so if n is here, if whenever I take any natural number higher than m, then the corresponding term of the sequence xm is less than x. If such a thing is happening, then I will pick that natural number n and I will put it in my set x. Okay. So when will I say that a element p is not there in this set S now? When I can find a natural number m such that m is greater than p, but xm is not less than xp. That is, xm is greater than or equal to xp. Okay, such a natural number p will not come in the set S. So S is a collection of natural numbers which satisfy this property. So it's a subset of n. Okay. Now this set S can either be finite or infinite. So I will break down the theorem into two parts. Case one is when S is finite, and case two when S is infinite. Okay. So let's see when S is finite, what we can get. There is one property which I forgot to mention, commonly known as well ordering property. Okay, I will just state it here because I want to use it. Well ordering property, which says every subset of natural numbers has a least element. A simple statement. every subset of natural numbers has a least element. Okay, so this is what I'll be using in the proof. No matter which subset of natural numbers you take, it will definitely have the smallest element, that is the least element. Now S is finite here, that means S will have finitely many natural numbers inside it. So what I will do, I will look at all the natural numbers which are there in S. There are finitely many in this case, and I will pick up a natural number which is bigger than all the natural numbers in this set. All right. So what I do is, I choose a natural number capital N. Choose a natural number capital N such that N will be bigger than or equal to K for every K in S. Okay, so this natural number capital N is bigger than or equal to all the elements of the set capital S. Geometrically, if you want to understand this, I will just put it on the number line. The elements which I'm marking in red, let's say they are the elements of S. Okay, and because they are finitely many, supposing they stop here, and this natural number capital N is chosen in such a way that all the numbers are less than or equal to capital N. So the elements of the set S are here, which are marked in red. So N is a natural number now. So given any natural number, I can find a natural number higher than that, right? So what I will do, I will pick a natural number n1 such that n1 is greater than capital N. So I will pick up a natural number here and I will call it n1. Now n1 definitely is not there inside the set S because it is after n, right? Then this natural number n1 will not come inside the set S. And when do you say that an element is not there inside the set S? I've stated that here. P is not there in S if there exists a natural number M such that M is greater than P and XM is greater than or equal to XP. Right? So N1 is not there in S. Therefore, there exists a natural number N2 such that N2 is greater than N1. Okay, N2 is greater than N1. N2 is playing the role of M here. So N2 is greater than N1, N XN2 is greater than or equal to XN1. Just compare this statement with this here. Okay, I hope that's clear. So I have N2 now, right? Now N2 is greater than N1 and N1 is greater than capital N. So N2 is here. Again, N2 is not there inside the set S. Again, N2 is not there inside the set S. And when do I say that a natural number N2 is not there inside the set S? Again, I can find one more natural number which will satisfy this property. Right? So therefore there exists N3 now such that N3 is greater than N2 and XN3 is greater than or equal to XN2, which in turn is greater than or equal to XN1. So can you see what is happening? I'm getting a sequence, subsequence of XN, XN1, XN2, XN3 and so on. And terms of that sequence are increasing, right? So I am able to find a monotonically increasing sequence, which is a subsequence of the given sequence. So continuing in this manner, continuing in this manner, we get a subsequence xn k of xn and what kind of a subsequence is this? Increasing subsequence. Okay, so we are able to find an increasing sequence from the given sequence when S is finite, right? So this finishes case one when S is finite. Now, if S is infinite, then what we can do? So case two is when S is infinite. Okay, let's recall what is S. If you go back and see, S is the set of all natural numbers such that for every m greater than n, xm must be less than xn. Okay, so that's how the set S is defined. Now let's look at the case when S is infinite. Now, when I say S is infinite, S is a subset of natural numbers and it's infinite set. Then by well ordering property, what do we know? Well ordering property says every subset of natural numbers has a least element, right? And I have a subset S now of natural numbers, which is an infinite set. S is a non-empty subset of N. Right. Therefore, by well ordering property, S has a least element. Right. So let's call it x1. Okay, let x1 no, that's a natural number, so let's call it n1. So n1 is the least element of the set S now. Okay, S is a set which has these natural numbers and n1 I have picked up to be the least one. Now what I will do from S, I will remove this element n1 which is already chosen here. Okay, then what I will get? I will get S difference n1, this set. Again, this is a subset of natural numbers and it is a non-empty set. Because from an infinite set, I'm removing one number. So that will still remain infinite. Right? Then let n2 be the least element of the set S difference n1. Okay, so n2 I have chosen here. One more point in the set S. Again, let n3 be the least element of S difference n1 and n2. So again, n2 I will remove from the set S. Again, the new set that is obtained is infinite. And again, I can pick up a least element from that set. Okay. So in this process, what I'm getting? I'm getting these numbers in the set S, n1, n2, n3. And n1 was the least in the set S. So n1 is less than n2, n2 is less than n3, and so on. Right? So continuing in this manner, we get n1, n2, n3 and so on. These elements in S such that n1 is less than n2, n2 is less than n3, n3 is less than n4 and so on. And in general, nk minus 1 will be less than nk and this keeps on going. Okay, I can keep on doing this. So now Nk minus 1 is the element of A and Nk minus 1 is less than Nk, right? All these elements, they are least elements of S. So they are elements of S. At each stage, I am picking a least element from the new set that I get. Right? So all these are elements of the set S itself. So Nk minus 1 is the element of S. And Nk minus 1 is less than Nk. Right? So elements of the set S, what is the property that they are having? This natural number nk minus 1 will come inside S if whenever I take a number nk which is greater than nk minus 1. If you go back to the set S and see here, a number p will come if whenever I take m greater than p, xm must be strictly less than xa here. Okay, not this one, it's this one. So here what is going to happen? Nk is greater than nk minus 1, right? So xnk will be less than xnk minus 1, and this will work for each and every element of the set S here. Now n1, n2, n3 and so on. Therefore we get a subsequence xnk of xn such that what will happen now? Xnk minus 1 is greater than xnk. So x1 is greater than x2, x2 is greater than x3, x3 is greater than x4, and so on. And what kind of a sequence is this? It's a decreasing sequence, right? So we get a decreasing sequence. I can change it here. We get a decreasing sequence xnk of xn. So in both the cases, what we have done? We have obtained an increasing sequence in case 1 and a decreasing sequence in case 2, right? Therefore, xn has a monotone subsequence in both the cases. Okay, and that's the conclusion. So whenever I take any sequence of real numbers, it will always have a monotone subsequence, and that's the conclusion of this theorem. Okay, so this proves this theorem. So henceforth, if I give you any sequence of real numbers, it should always have a monotone subsequence. Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem says that every bounded sequence of real numbers has a convergent subsequence. That means if you pick up any sequence xn of real numbers which is bounded, then I don't know whether this xn is convergent or not. I only know that it is bounded. So from a bounded sequence, I can obtain a subsequence xnk which will be convergent. Okay, so every bounded sequence of real numbers will have a convergent subsequence. That's what is called Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem. So before proving this, I want to state one property which I want you all to prove. Okay, I will only state it. Every subsequence of a bounded sequence is bounded. Okay, that is, if xn is bounded and let xnk be a subsequence of xn. Okay, be a subsequence of xn. Then xnk will also be bounded. Okay, and it's very easy to see that the subsequence will be bounded. Okay, so see that you give an argument for this. So I will leave this as an exercise and I will use it here. Okay, so let xn be a bounded sequence of real numbers. I'll start with a bounded sequence of real numbers. Let xn be a bounded sequence of real numbers. Then by previous theorem, I can find a monotone subsequence for the sequence, right? Therefore, by previous theorem, there exists a monotone subsequence xnk, I will call it, of xn, right? So this xnk will be a monotonic subsequence of xn, so either it will be increasing or decreasing. Also, since xn is bounded, xn is given to be a bounded sequence. The subsequence xnk is also bounded. Right? Because every subsequence of a bounded sequence is bounded. That's what we said just now. So xnk is bounded. So therefore, this subsequence xnk is a monotonic, is a monotone and bounded subsequence of xn. Right? And if a sequence is monotone and bounded, then it converges. Therefore, xnk is convergent. We have done a result in this chapter which says if a sequence is increasing and bounded above, then it is convergent. And if it is decreasing and bounded below, then it is convergent. Right? So when I say bounded, it is both bounded above as well as below. And when I say monotone, it will be either increasing or decreasing. Right? So xnk will be a convergent subsequence of xn, and that's what this theorem says. So whatever matter was required to prove Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem has been put in the previous theorem, and that theorem is being used here. Okay, so every bounded sequence of real numbers has a convergent sequence. This is called Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem, and we have proved it. All right, so that's it for this session, and these are my references. Thank you.